G'day YouTubers, and welcome to the second part with the Look Inside Fluke, the Measure of Innovation 2015. So what was the key topic of this event? It was thermography and reliability. So thermography, hopefully reasonably easy to understand. It's the technical art of using thermal cameras to investigate either industrial equipment to pre-diagnose potential issues which might become failures in the future. Thermography, of course, can be used in a wide range of industries, from medical to industrial to electrical, all sorts. So that was one of the key topics. Lots of experts from around the world. They, prior to the start of the actual conference, they had thermography courses for people to kind of get their certifications. So those folks were there as well. And then reliability. So reliability is an interesting topic. I certainly, if you asked me what reliability meant before the event, I wouldn't have been able to give you much of an answer. But reliability in terms of this event is understanding the reliability of industrial environments, like processes, big industrial factories where you've got machinery, motors, electrical works. Those become a big issue for large industry, trying to ensure that you keep them up and running 24/7 in some cases. If you have downtime, your downtime potentially costs a lot more than the piece of equipment that has failed. Although in some cases, the pieces of equipment that might fail can be expensive as well. So the whole idea behind reliability is doing preemptive observation of equipment to ensure you try and prevent excessive maintenance or failure on equipment. And the key focus of this event was things like which are non-contact or non-invasive ways of trying to take measurements to understand whether a piece of equipment is performing properly or whether there's potential for it to fail in the future. And those were either taking thermal images or vibration, using a vibration meter. Now, there were some very interesting keynote speakers who came along to the event. I did take some video. It is very long video, so unfortunately I cannot post it on this channel because I do not have enough video slots to do that. If there's enough interest after I've kind of gone into a little bit of detail about the folks and what they're talking about, I'll post it on another channel. So to start off the tour, I mentioned we did go to Boeing. The Boeing facility was just kind of a nice add-on tour because it's not too far from Fluke Everett. We weren't allowed to take any cameras inside. The rationale behind that, the gent who's giving us the tour of Boeing said that because when you go in this tour, the buildings, the hangars are huge. They are apparently, if I've got my facts right, the largest buildings, certainly in terms of per volume, in the world. You could fit, and I forget whether it's Disney World or Disneyland, the one in California, you could fit that inside these buildings and still have space for a huge amount of parking. So they are huge. But when you go and do the tour, you've got, for one, you've got these huge, long, almost quarter mile walkways underneath, underground, where all the utilities are run. And then you go up inside, you go up in these kind of huge industrial elevators or lifts up to higher gangways where you can overlook and have a look at the production facility for the 767, the 777, and the 787. And their rationale for not having cameras is that there was a risk that people leaning over taking photographs might drop a camera or something onto folks working below. I'm sure there are other reasons, but nonetheless, it was a great tour and hats off to Fluke for actually taking us there so we could experience that. The tour of the Fluke facilities was particularly interesting. For me, obviously, of what was of great interest was the calibration and metrology labs. We were told initially up front that we could take video and photographs, so I certainly didn't take anything along to make notes. Once we got in there, the gent inside who gave us a tour said that we couldn't take photographs, and I respect that he was unsure. So for the most part, I didn't take photographs, and there was a lot of information. Then later we said, can we take photographs? He asked, said, yes, you can do. So it was a quick rush to take photographs and some video before the next group came through to have a look at the facility. So unfortunately, I don't have a huge amount of information. But I'll just highlight, you'll see, I'll put up a photograph, for instance. They've got a Josephson voltage standard there. I'm going to link to some information below the technical workings of this device, this standard, and I'm unsure whether it's a 1 volt or a 10 volt standard, but I found some very interesting PDFs and technical write-ups of how this all works, obviously using a superconducted junctions, multiple junctions, which are super cooled using a nitrogen to just above absolute zero. And doing this, they can achieve a good, accurate, but more importantly, stable voltage. And a stable voltage that is accurate to parts per billion with a B, as opposed to parts per million, as a, let's say, some of the voltage standards that I have. Now, just recently, I've gone and purchased another 10 volt standard. And of course, this is a lot simpler than the big voltage standard that they have at Fluke, which they calibrate some of their key equipment against. My little voltage standard here, 10 volt voltage standard, which I'll review because I must say it seems to be a very nice device, nice and stable for the short term that I've had it. Some interesting facts and figures on the standard deviation on this. But this is 2 parts per million, whereas they go down to, if I remember correctly, 5 parts per billion. So it was fascinating seeing that equipment. They've got some really nice current standards there. They've got lots of transfer standards which they ship out to other labs so that they can cross-reference their voltage standards to make sure that they're not drifting or whether they need recalibration. The next thing we were taken through was their test labs. And part of the test lab tour, they actually took us into the whole design process behind the Fluke vibration meter, the Fluke 805. I've actually got a review of that on my channel, which I did many years ago. They went through the process where they go out to customers, they get customer feedback, they understand what the kind of issues with existing vibration measurement technology was, and how they got down to a very compact and very usable device to make vibration measurement more accurate and the results more repeatable, because that's potentially one of the issues. If you're using a device, there's potentially a lot of user error in the way that the operator is using the device to ensure they get a correct reading. And then the sensors inside can be subject to change, which means there can be inaccuracies in the readings. So they've done put a lot of forethought and design into that to come up with the 805. Another big key point about this, the whole conference, was Fluke Connect is getting to the point where almost all their tool sets in the future will be able to communicate and link up and record their results, so that you can have folk out in the field, as I've demonstrated, with either electrical measurement equipment, vibration equipment, thermal imagery. All that information can be taken, it can be collated, analyzed. You can build a trend over time so that you can see whether potentially you're going to have equipment that's going to fail. You can start trending, forming baselines, and for instance, a single piece of equipment like a motor, you've got electrical issues you have to look at, vibrational issues, and thermal heating issues to understand and look at all of those to see whether you potentially got a problem which could develop into a big maintenance issue or a fault. That it's one of the big firsts in the industry where a test and measurement company is trying to pull that all together into a useful tool set. Now, I will say, and you'll know if you go back to my review of the Fluke Connect equipment, I've gone and made some criticisms about some things that they could improve. I think the idea and the concept behind it is brilliant. We had a lot of open, honest, interesting discussion because they showed us the next step with Fluke Connect, where it gets into more asset management. And there was a lot of honest feedback there to say whether they were going in the right direction or whether they were doing thing, perhaps going about it in the right way. And I certainly voiced an opinion and perhaps a little bit of criticism in what they were doing. But even though I'd say I'd perhaps give some concern in the way they were doing things, they are at least doing it. And even if they are going along a path which might not quite be the right path now, at least they're doing something in the industry, which at the moment, other folks are going to play catch up to. So hopefully they get it right, because the whole idea behind collecting data remotely for further analysis and trending makes a lot of sense. And that was one of the key focal points of this conference. So after we had gone and seen the workings of the 805, we then went through their test lab. And in their test lab, the engineer, for one, I showed you in the previous video, they showed us the issues potentially with multimeters that can explode if you don't have the right safety measures in them or the right fuses. And in the following videos that I'm going to show you, they went through and showed us, for instance, they've got an environmental test chamber where they do testing. You'll see they also do to see how electromagnetic forces or radio waves might affect their devices. They've got these coils where they are built up, where they will put in a device subjected to a certain magnetic field to see if that's going to have an effect. The environmental chamber kind of does accelerated life testing. They've also got this kind of test drop box. You see they've got a wooden box, they place a multimeter in there. Someone initially built this as their own test in-house, and you rotate this box and the multimeter, whatever measurement device or whatever device, the measurement device I want to test, then goes through and it is dropped repeatedly to see how it will stand up to that. And that kind of test at the moment isn't an existing standard, and you'll see there's another photograph where they've actually gone and purchased a more production device which will actually count the rotations and do better noting of the results of that dropping. So that was a test lab, and I'll just lead you into the video so you can see what that's all about.
We have a custom built fixture that we use to test meters when they're being used on with digital motor controllers and high amperage motors for three-phase systems. We found that when you have a digital motor controller, there's so much noise being put on the line that it uses to manage the speed of the motor that it can interfere with the management of the product. So we have built a fixture so that we can test that. And so we test EMMs and clamp meters to try and induce the meter to lock up or give an inaccurate reading. Anybody that has an 87.5 multimeter, you may notice that there is a low frequency setting on the meter, and that's specifically to filter out that high frequency noise to give you a more accurate reading. It's very possible to get on you're measuring a main circuit and it's giving you an inaccurate reading. Well, it's because the signal is so disturbed. 50 hertz or 60 hertz signal that you're looking at is so disturbed that the meter gets confused in its measurement function. So you have to be aware of how clean the signal is that you're measuring. We also have a test lead fixture that we use to measure test leads. Even though they looked at a product like this and think this is the important part, typically you always have a pair of test leads attached. And those are an important part. We have tested that reliability of those. As many times a meter like this is taken, measurements taken, the test leads are wrapped around and then thrown in a toolbox and lies around the bottom of a truck. And that's the kind of environment that we're looking at testing for. Along that regard, this is a two-axis vibration table where we test products. We'll pull the product down and then shake it in all three axes, looking for components that will fall off or some other damage that will occur. Again, this kind of simulates lighting around in the bottom of a truck or tool bag for years. And so we want to see what the reliability of the construction is and the overall product before we put it in the customer's hands.
Do you ever ship stuff FedEx or UPS and see how it responds to?
We don't use FedEx, but we have another drop station that I'll show you here in a minute, and we'll talk about that. Okay? Any questions? Accelerated life testing. This chamber goes from plus 200 to minus 100 degrees C, 60 degrees C per minute. It's actually fed by liquid nitrogen so that we can achieve those rapid temperature changes. The idea is that the more extreme and more rapid temperature changes that you can induce into a product accelerates its life. And so you'll be able to see how well the product and the components are designed. Typically, a lot of Fluke products went through this accelerated life testing, but now we pretty much understand what the design limits of the product are, and pretty much design products all the same way, with the same kind of plastics, the same kind of manufacturing process. So typically not every single product gets live testing done on anymore, but we at one point we did extensive testing on it. Kind of our new thing that we do for reliability is called a tumble tester. It's a kind of a new thing in, for a standard that we found, and so we made one. One of our technicians made one, and the idea is that you put the product in here and you start tumbling it, and so every time it rolls, it drops a meter, or drops a product 1 meter every for every rotation. And so after a couple of 100 or 150 cycles, you pull it out and take a look and see how good your design is. And we've learned a thing or two about things that we thought were very well designed and turned out not to be. The issue is that there's really no requirement to do this or specification about how robust a product needs to be in order to survive. It's kind of, okay, does the product survive 100 cycles? Okay, that's pretty good. 150, even better. So we're still trying to determine what the baseline is for a good product design. When you take the product and cool it down to its minimum operating temperature, and then put it on here and drop it onto the hardwood board. Now that's a 1 meter drop onto a specified density board, and we do that 6 times.
Sure.
Well, pop it another face here. And I love my meter.
Your meter's not so sure about that.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a love-hate relationship here. So, this test actually is a requirement in the 61010 standard that we report to CSA. This is a laboratory that's actually qualified by CSA to be essentially a ancillary laboratory, so they accept our test results. There's several of us that are qualified to sign reports for CSA. And then they come down and audit us about once a quarter to make sure that we're still doing the testing correctly and auditing the product lines. Drop station used to test shipping containers. So in addition to testing the product itself, we also test the packaging that the product will go in. Typically this is for bigger bench type mains powered products that you wouldn't be floating around like this. And so you put the shipping container on here, typically a cardboard box, lift it up a specified distance depending on its weight, and then you drop it. And we drop it 26 times, and then open it up and check the product to make sure that it's still operating or to see if it's damaged, see if the design of the packaging has to be improved. Anybody want to guess why we drop it 26 times?
Average trip.
Huh?
You're putting
27
over breaking? Nope. If you take a cube and each face and each edge and each corner, it adds up to 26. Yeah. So you drop it on each one of those points. As you can see, we since we thought so much of the tumble tester that we built, but we went out and got an actual model of it that is suitable for the actual standards testing, and with a real motor and a real counters and things. So in the future, we're going to be using this much more as a reliability and robustness test, more than just a single block that the standard requires. This is our EMC chamber. We use it for emissions and immunity testing. So every product typically has a clock in it and it has some power source. So we need to check to make sure the emissions of the product don't exceed FCC and CE requirements for creating CE declarations. So we will measure a product here to look for frequencies that the product is generating, and then we'll go to an outside area test site that we have and perform actual measurements out there. If we find, if we find things to look at. This room is also used for immunity testing, so we have a calibrated uniform field at this point, so we can radiate frequencies at 3 volts per meter, typically, to test products to make sure that there's no abnormal changes in the release. And this, again, this is a requirement for CE declarations, but it's just good standard practice. We were doing it, Fluke was doing it before as a robustness and reliability issue, but now there are some serious international requirements to perform the tests. And so the these absorbers actually will absorb RF energy, and so they're placed strategically to eliminate reflections. The black squares you see on the wall are ferrites. absorb dust chamber. So when we test products, we'll put them in there and circulate talc around it for 8 hours. And then we'll open up the product to see whether there's any contamination inside. That is the first number in an IP rating called, typically they're addressed as, well, if you look at the 28.2 model Fluke meter, it's rated to IP67. So 6 is the dust part of that with a vacuum applied. We're actually trying to pull the dust into the product. The other part is the 7, and that's a water test. There's 7 levels of it. And we test 1 level, it's at IP5. A product has to be able to survive water getting inside by having that stream of water fall on it. The actual 7 rating on the IP67 is to be submerged to 1 meter for 30 minutes in order and then pass the electrical tests after that, and plus the inspection to see whether water date got inside. We do that test here using this tank. It allows us to fill it up to 1 meter, and so we can have it down, submerge it to 1 meter for 30 minutes. If it looks like a sewer pipe, that's because it is.
Then one of the other tours that we had was of the Fluke Museum. And the Fluke Museum, it's not a separate building. When you come into the foyer of the Fluke facility, they've got these glass cases and plaques up on the wall where they show, for instance, some of the first device that John Fluke Sr. developed, which started his name in Fluke right through the ages, where they go through all the bits and pieces. So a really interesting tour. The gent that gave us the tour had actually worked for Fluke for many years. He started, I think, if I recall correctly, 18 years after Fluke officially started the Fluke Corporation. And that was the interesting thing. I'll say now, although I may have some criticisms of the way Fluke operate, the one thing they do have in their favor is good folk that work there. They've got folk with legacy. They've got people who have worked there for 25, 30, 40, 40 years plus, as well as younger folk who are perhaps more dynamic in their thinking in terms of application development. So they certainly have a nice dynamic range of people, just good people to actually talk to. I sat and met a lot of people that I've only interacted with perhaps over email or via a conference call, and it was a pleasure meeting them in person. Often we didn't even speak about things related to Fluke, it were other bits and pieces, and they are just good human beings. And I think Fluke as a corporation are very fortunate to have those types of people working for them. Now, besides the museum tour, the other thing we did get to go on was a trip to their production facilities. So as noted, there was no photography, no video. I probably can't disclose any detail of the facilities. All I will say is that they certainly do have a very clean and what seems to be a very efficient production facility. I was fortunate enough, I told Dan Wright that I had an interest in perhaps going and have a looking at the Fluke 287-289 assembly, and he arranged me to do that. So I went by myself with Dan. I think there was one other gent that came along. Dan brought along the guy that oversaw that area, and I was able to ask him a lot of questions about the 287, 289s, the way they were assembled. So I really appreciate that. We then got to see how the thermal cameras are put together, the existing models plus the newer models, which we'll talk about at the end of the video. They obviously want to make their production facility as efficient as possible because they want to maximize their profit margin. They also want to ensure that they're putting out products there which aren't going to be returned, because that in turn costs the company. After these tours, at the end of each day, and the reason the days went on to about 8 o'clock at night, the kind of formal conference kind of ended at 5 o'clock, and then there was a social. So they put on a social for the day two. The press, the kind of industrial press, were there to kind of sit and talk to the experts who had come from around the world, and obviously folks at Fluke. So there were these socials where you got to mingle and interact with either the other folks who had arrived from around the world or from folks at Fluke. And Dan Wright kindly arranged me to have a chat with Paul Hadron. And as mentioned, Paul Hadron is one of the senior engineers at Fluke. And I'll say straight off, the really enjoyable thing was I didn't feel like I was speaking to an engineer who was aloof and was just trying to feed me a corporate spiel. He was genuinely interested in my concerns, and where I was talking to him about the issues which had been raised about the Fluke 287, 289. And he was genuinely interested in my wish list in terms of what I would like to see in a future multimeter. This is the kind of feedback that he thrives on as an engineer. I would almost call him a test and measurement geek. He's genuinely interested in that, and he enjoys improvements in the engineering. So he was listening to what I was saying. Some of the things I was telling him, he said, we've already noted that. It is something we've got covered in a future product release. And some of them he said, okay, we'll see what we can do. Now, in terms of the issues which have been brought to their attention, and I'll talk about, and this is one of the places that I will again openly criticize or perhaps say that there's room for improvement at Fluke. I previously have done videos where I highlighted the issue with the Fluke 287, 289, where if there was light going into the IR port, it would, when you were data logging, it would freeze up and just stop. And then just more recently, there's the supercapacitor, which retains the real-time clock. And my criticism there is that it's taken for each of those issues over a year for Fluke to come back, not respond. In some cases, they've acknowledged, but they've not come back with a proper acknowledgement saying, yes, we're working on the issue, or yeah, there's a few challenges and we're going to fix it. There might be an acknowledgement that they've received your communication, which in some cases they actually didn't. But then only after a year did you get an official, yes, okay, we've worked out what the issue is and we're going to correct it. And that was something I was chatting to Paul about. And Paul actually gave me insight into behind the scenes in terms of the effort that it took them to resolve, for instance, the issue with the light going into the IR port. He went into a bit of detail there. I won't discuss that detail, but I said to him, it's that kind of detail which, if you openly communicated with the general public, your customers who are buying this equipment, when there's an issue raised, tell them the challenges you're having. I think they'd have far more respect than a year of silence where you don't come back and say that you're doing something concrete about working to resolve that kind of issue. And that is both, I say, on the IR port issue, which they eventually did resolve after a lot of prodding, and then now with the supercapacitor battery, which has got that brown corrosion or brown residue, which is potentially causing issues. Now, I say potentially because Paul gave me some honest insight, saying that as far as they can see, they haven't come across any real true information which says it's going to cause corrosion on the PCB. He did say, however, they've seen instances where there is corrosion, but it looks like there may be an instance where, let's say, perhaps there's somehow moisture that's got mixed in and causing an issue, and they cannot say whether it's definitely due to that capacitor or another issue coming into it. And it's something they are going to address in future revisions of that board. Before we kind of talk about the new thermal cameras which Fluke brought out, and then the kind of other end of the market, I just want to talk about some of the keynote speakers that were there. There were some brilliant keynote speakers. Some of them, their conversation that stuck in my mind was the conversation by Dave Hart, a gent from the UK. He works for a company that deals in global customer transformation at a company called ServiceMax, and I'll put the links below. So if you want to go and find out more about these folks, very kind of insightful, well-spoken gent. The other person was Mary Bunzel. Now she works for IBM, and her area of expertise is enterprise asset management. Now IBM have got an application suite called Maximo. I certainly don't know much about it, but I do know it's a suite to manage industrial assets in terms of analyzing equipment, to track it, to understand potential maintenance issues. She gave a very interesting conversation and chat about the Internet of Things in terms of, particularly in the industrial setting, having sensors and monitors on all aspects of a production line, so that if you've got any issues, you can, let's say for instance, you've got a product and 3 years in its life cycle, once it's gone out into the field and customers are using it, you suddenly get a problem which comes up, that you can go back in time and trace when it went through the production line and understand any obscure reason that might have caused an issue which resulted in a problem or a failure 3 years later. And in that talk that she gave, she actually cited an example of such a case where they had to trace something back to a really obscure issue within the production cycle for that, within that week of production, which was causing a failure some years down the line. So a really interesting conversation, and that's one of those which I'll say it's quite long, but if you're interested, I'll post it on another channel for you. Then there was Dr. Robert Madding. Now Dr. Robert Madding, or I think he's known as Dr. Bob, he was also there. He has been a renowned person in the area of thermography and thermal imaging right from the 70s to current day, in terms of giving talks on the technology and understanding and training on this. One of the interesting things I walked away from and I brought up was there's a lot of growth on the kind of improvement and the specifications on thermal cameras. Fluke obviously is trying to progress and improve this area by using Fluke Connect, so that you can take the images and measurements that you get from thermal cameras and what have you to improve analysis and trending over time. All these companies, whether it's Fluke, FLIR, or whoever, need to jump in and look at the kind of work that Eric Bell is doing in terms of making thermal cameras more intelligent, so that right there and then the person who's pointing this and using it can gain some very useful and valuable information right there while he's pointing it at a potential issue. At the moment, to use a thermal camera and to understand what the correct use of a camera and analyze the images that you get from a camera, you need a good level of training, and you need a good level of training in the area that you're using it. For instance, if you're using a camera in the medical world, you need an understanding specific to the medical world. If you're using a camera in the industrial world looking at motors and heavy industry equipment, you need specific training for that. If you're looking at electrical installations, there's specific training for that. And one of the things which is muddying the water at the moment is potentially the introduction of these cheaper lower end cameras, where anyone and their dog can now buy a camera for $100, $200, $300. And folks are walking around thinking now they have a level of expertise to diagnose what's going on when they're pointing their thermal camera. And this certainly for the experts is an issue, because you get these people coming in trying to provide services and they don't understand the technology or how to analyze it. And it costs a lot of money on the other hand to become an expert and go to this training to understand what thermal imagery is all about. And there, I think, is where Eric Bell comes in, and he's trying to create a technology where there's intelligence in the camera, where the camera can recognize what it's looking at and, for instance, give you an understanding and diagnosis right there on the spot. And I'll give you a potential example. If you are pointing a thermal camera at a DB board or a breaker box, you're not going to necessarily understand if you've got a certain hot spot at a breaker, whether that's good or bad. Whereas if you've got the right intelligence, the camera would be able to recognize what it's looking at, a breaker box. It would perhaps be able to recognize the type of breakers and, let's say, the current rating for those breakers. And by understanding that, and let's say then seeing what the thermal measurement is at that hot spot, could say, ah, that thermal reading is perhaps getting to a point where it's out of range, it is out of range, or it's safe for the rating of the type of breaker that's in there. And that is just a small part of the intelligence that Eric Bell is looking at. He's already disclosed some very interesting concepts which you could potentially do with this technology, things which I won't talk about. I don't want to compromise the work that he's doing. But I think both FLIR and FLIR have got some work to do, because that's the kind of technology potentially that you want built in. This could also fluke, let's say, for instance, with the intelligence of connecting your equipment to the cloud or the internet. It could go up to a shared database where someone sitting in India looking at a motor in an industrial area there, which is new and is not seen in another part of the world. Someone could be in South Africa. They may have that same motor, and when he pulls out his thermal camera, it looks up to the cloud and says, ah, I can recognize that. Someone has already done trending over time on it. This is the motor in front of me, and I can understand from the readings and the information that I'm getting back, whether it's within specification or not, or whether there's a concern that there might be a future maintenance issue. And that's the kind of intelligence which I say I would like to see happening in the thermography area in the future, and something that Eric Bell potentially is looking at and addressing at the moment. So I'm not going to go into too much detail on the Fluke cameras. That is something I'll set aside for a future video. I'll just say that I'll talk about the model numbers. I'm going to add links below. They've brought out, there's the Fluke TIX1000, TIX660, TIX640. These are all high-end cameras. They've got high resolution, very good optics. They've got the TIX560 and 520. Now, for the most part, as I said, these cameras are kind of in the tens of thousands of dollars, kind of $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 range. I saw some of these in action. Sat Sandhu, a good gent also from the UK, who works at Fluke in the UK, he was demonstrating how by putting a kind of a lens which magnified the optics into one of these thermal cameras, you could do microscopic measurements of ICs and look at, let's say, potential shorts. So if you have a circuit that's not working and you pull it out of production and have a look at it under one of these cameras, you could see the little small microscopic lines glowing where there was a short circuit because of the production process for that IC. So that was fascinating to see. Certainly for the larger group of this audience, that's not going to be the application that you're looking at with these cameras, and they're at the top end. If you do have a real interest in seeing the potential of these cameras, then make it known in this video. If there's enough interest, maybe Fluke will send me one on loan and we can have a look at it, because there are some interesting comparisons with perhaps with even the low-end cameras, which I'm going to talk about now. So the world of thermal cameras is becoming very interesting. Not too long ago, it would have cost you tens of thousands of dollars to have a thermal imager or thermal camera in your hands. I can remember, again, early in my video blogging days, Comptest in South Africa provided me, if I remember correctly, it was the TI-125. This is the TI-190 that Fluke kindly put on my hands. This one, by having, it's got a little SD card which provides connectivity to Fluke Connect. So even with these older cameras, you can now insert these cards and they can become connected, and then all the potential intelligence that Fluke Connect can provide can be unleashed in equipment like this. However, you do pay a premium for these cameras, and that's just why I want to talk about what's happening in the bottom end of the market. I'm going to be doing a video where I put all of these side by side to try and understand within my expertise on kind of thermal images, which is very limited. But I want to show you some of the pros and cons that each of these may offer. Previously, I've spoken about, for instance, on the FLIR cameras, they've got a nice wide angled field of view, which can be really handy if you're trying to scope around a big area to find a problem. However, if you've got the same resolution in a narrower field of view, you get better resolution for measurement. So that's something I want to highlight. The other interesting aspect, and I'll say that at the moment, just the other day, I got a company that sells FLIR cameras has noted that this has dropped from $499 to $399. So the price war continues. So the TG165 can now be had for $399. Whether that's because there's something else coming out onto the market, I don't know. But I'll highlight that HT Instruments have gone and put the THT45 into my hands. Now, at the Solar Power International, they demonstrated one of these to me. They've just released them into Europe. They're not yet on sale in America, as far as I know, but they do plan to be under $1,000. Now, the interesting thing about these is that the one thing they do above some of the other cheaper cameras is, again, they do provide a fusion between a normal image and a thermal image, which some of these other ones provide. But many of these don't provide you with manual focus. They've got a fixed focal range, so as long as you're at the right distance, your thermal image will be within focus. But of course, that's not always going to be the point. Sometimes you might be closer to something, sometimes you're going to be a distance away from something. And to obtain a better thermal image to analyze, you want that to be in focus, and they are providing that manual focus at sub $1,000. The other key ingredient that this does offer above the others is the update frequency of the thermal sensor. For the most part in the States, they all sell an update at 9 Hz. So you can only go to the shop and buy one that operates at 9 Hz. Now, the reason for that is there are certain restrictions here in the States due to military applications. They don't want, for the most part, the general public to have cameras that operate above that, because they consider then it could be used for military uses. You can, and I was chatting to a marketing person at Fluke, and I was asking them about the challenge. Fluke do sell these cameras that work at 60 Hz. You have to go through a lot of paperwork to get them. From my understanding is that Fluke will help customers through that process, because it's potentially an arduous process. However, companies like HT Instruments or European companies can bring cameras into the American market that operate at, let's say, 50, 60 Hz. This one operates at 50 Hz. It potentially then gives it a great advantage against the other ones in the kind of same market point or price point, because it does operate at 50 Hz. And 50 Hz, forget the military applications. There are many applications where you want to do a measurement where you've got high speed rotational issues. So you could have a motor, you've got thermal issues which are moving at high speed, and that's where the high frequency, let's say 50 Hz, gives you a far smoother image that you can work from. And that's what these do. And by all accounts, they don't have the same restrictions as the American equipment. Now, could potentially be a hot topic for debate. Is that fair that the likes of Fluke or FLIR are restricted in their own market, whereas a European company isn't? That's an interesting one which we can debate in time to come. But nonetheless, when I do the full review, that those are the advantages of, let's say, HT Instruments and this THT45. But we'll do a full review on that in the future. But anyway, thank you. I hope that's given you a bit of insight into a few days that I spent at Fluke. I will certainly follow up if people want those conversations or those things that are recorded from the people giving the keynotes. I'll do that if there's enough interest. There really needs to be enough interest for me to go and do that and put it up on another channel. And then again, we'll follow up with review where we have a look at all these meters, which are sub $1,500, to see the pros and cons of each of them. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.